On January 8th, 2018, Elon Musk's rocket company launched a super top-secret spy satellite with stealth laser nuclear impact hypersonic gliding ballistic planet-destroying capabilities, and it totally blew up, and SpaceX super failed.
Guys, we need to talk. After countless emails, tweets, and YouTube comments asking for my thoughts on the Zuma mission, it's time we separate the facts from the rumors and conspiracies and do some journalism instead of sensationalism. We're gonna lay down the actual known, observable, and concrete facts. We'll do this by showing you what we actually know of the mission itself and compare that to other similar previously classified missions. And then we'll clarify what things are just simply rumors. I kind of can't believe I'm actually doing this one, but nevertheless, let's get started.
3, 2, 1, 0, and liftoff! One more step for
man. On January 8th, 2018, SpaceX launched what appeared to be a perfectly normal mission, carrying a classified payload simply known as Zuma. The webcast was normal. Well, at least for a classified mission, showing the separation of the first and second stage, and then only tracking the first stage as it headed back to land at Cape Canaveral. The webcast wrapped up, and we all said good night and cheers to SpaceX and the payload's manufacturer, Northrop Grumman. We all went on our merry ways. But soon after what was thought to be a perfectly successful mission, the Wall Street Journal and Bloomberg reported that the Zuma payload failed to get into orbit, both citing unknown government officials. This caused a fury of speculation and half-baked conspiracy theories, even leading to some awkward press conference events where one reporter was demanding that the Department of Defense speaks up and spills the beans.
This is a billion-dollar or so satellite. It's been 4 days. Was it a success or a failure? And what's the fate of the satellite?
Again, I would have to refer you to them. And that's the answer.
General, I mean, is the satellite in orbit?
I'm with Dana. We're not going to be able to give you any more information. So,
the most common theory is that the payload didn't detach from the upper stage of the Falcon 9 and wound up re-entering alongside the upper stage. Now, just a real quick reminder here before we move on. SpaceX simply launches a payload to its intended destination, and that's the end of their mission. They're a launch provider, and their job is to deliver something to space. This is not that much different from UPS dropping off a box and having the customer sign for it. What happens once it's in the customer's hands is no longer having anything to do with UPS, or in this case, SpaceX. Okay folks, time to sit back and go over everything we actually know. Zuma first appeared on the public's radar mid-October 2017 with information found in an FCC filings that suggested plans for an upcoming Falcon 9 rocket launch with an unidentified payload that was to launch about 1 month away from the filing. SpaceX has to apply for special authority from the FCC to use telemetry transmitters and receivers for tracking every launch, just like any other launch provider. The only strange thing here was how quickly the launch was to occur from its initial filings to the launch date, and the fact that the payload was entirely unknown. Otherwise, it was actually pretty normal here. The next bit we learned was that no government agency was stepping forward to claim responsibility. Unlike more normal classified launches for the National Reconnaissance Office or the Air Force or any of the other dozen or so military and intelligence agencies. But it's not unheard of to have an entirely unclaimed satellite launch. As a matter of fact, a similar launch occurred on May 26, 2009, known only as Pan. It launched on top of ULA's Atlas V rocket, and very little was known and is known about the mission. About the only thing we do know is it went to geostationary orbit and was built by Lockheed Martin. Another similar launch occurred on September 16, 2014, with the successful launch of Clio on board another Atlas V. Again, little is known, but it's thought to be a brother of the Pan satellite. SpaceX has previously launched two classified missions so far. One for the National Reconnaissance Office with mission NROL-76, which launched on May 1st, 2017, and one for the Air Force with mission OTV-5, which launched their secretive Boeing X-37 space plane on September 7th, 2017. But again, these are a little more standard scenarios because we know which government agency was the customer. The next thing we know is that Northrop Grumman manufactured the payload, which they announced late October 2017, but no more information was given. Northrop Grumman is a very large aerospace and defense technology company that's famously manufactured iconic vehicles like the B-2 stealth bomber, and they're the primary contractor for the upcoming $8.7 billion James Webb Space Telescope. We also know where the payload headed. Based on the Air Force's published exclusion zone, it shows the rocket headed on a 51-degree inclination to the equator, This is very similar to the International Space Station, meaning it does cover a good amount of the globe. We also know there is a little bug with the payload fairing, which caused SpaceX to stand down from their first target launch date of November 15th, 2017. They tweeted, "Standing down on Zuma mission to take a closer look at data from recent fairing testing for another customer." This isn't particularly noteworthy and doesn't give us any glimpses into the mission. Stuff like this happens often, and if something pops up on one manufactured part, it's always better to test all other parts manufactured the same way. During the launch, we noticed that it must be a fairly lightweight payload considering how early the first stage separated from the second stage. At just around 2 minutes and 22 seconds after liftoff, we see main engine cutoff, or MECO, while the rocket is traveling around 6,000 kilometers an hour. Main engine cutoff and the velocity were almost identical to the CRS-13 mission, which SpaceX successfully launched on December 15th, 2017. This was a pretty light payload, weighing in at just 2,205 kilograms or 4,850 pounds. So the Zuma payload is probably in that same ballpark. The heavier and or the higher the orbit of the payload, the more work the first stage needs to do. That's why missions that go to a higher geostationary orbit have to land on a drone ship downrange, and why missions to low Earth orbit can actually turn around and land back on land. Zuma also appeared on spacetrack.org with the designation USA 280, which actually suggests that it did make it into orbit, since they don't seem to register something that doesn't make it at least one full successful orbit. All craft that make it above the Kármán line, which is 100 kilometers or 62 miles in altitude, are considered suborbital until they complete one orbit. Next, we have visual confirmation of a good deorbit burn from a pilot named Peter Horstink. Peter is a Dutch pilot who was flying a 747-400 from Amsterdam to Johannesburg and spotted the spectacular scene of a deorbit burn while flying at around 10,000 meters or 35,000 feet above Sedan. Most launch providers intentionally deorbit the spent second stage after successful payload deployment whenever possible to help keep space junk to a minimum. After a successful deorbit burn, it's normal for the stage to vent its remaining fuel so to minimize potential explosions. So what Peter caught while flying was the venting after a successful deorbit burn of the upper stage. This is excellent outside confirmation of the second stage performing nominally. Dr. Marco Langbrook wrote a great article all about this deorbit event and was even able to determine based on the star background the approximate altitude of the upper stage. He calculated it was around 900 kilometers. Check out his in-depth rundown. I've got a link to it in the description below. It's very cool. The last bit of information we have is from SpaceX themselves, who had to release a statement after several articles came out saying mysterious SpaceX satellite failed and other potentially misleading headlines. SpaceX President Gwynne Shotwell released this statement about the mission. "For clarity, after review of all data, Falcon 9 did everything correctly on Sunday night. If we or others find otherwise based on further review, we will report it immediately. Information published that is contrary to the statement is categorically false. Due to the classified nature of the payload, no further comment is possible." To add to this, two frequent customers, SES and Iridium, who both have upcoming flights with the Falcon 9, have come out publicly to mention that they've also reviewed all relevant data and they're still confident with SpaceX. And really, this probably is the most information we'll receive, but it says a lot. If SpaceX had no problems on their end and is not standing down for any kind of review for future launches, like they would if there was a failure, it certainly points to there being no issues on their end. Anything beyond this is simply unknown. But nonetheless, here's the unknowns. It's rumored that SpaceX didn't supply the payload adapter that releases the payload from the upper stage like they would for a normal customer. Instead, on this occasion, it sounds like the payload adapter was provided by Northrop Grumman. This leads to speculation that if the payload had failed to detach from the upper stage, it would be accurate for SpaceX to announce they had no issues, even if the actual primary mission had failed on Northrop Grumman's end. If the payload did fail to detach from the upper stage, there's not too much you could do. Rockets in general are pre-programmed, not just SpaceX's rockets, but all rockets. There are only a few commands that can be sent in flight, including the Go Boomy feature. But changing a pre-programmed flight input isn't one of the things they can change on the fly. The next unknown is if the payload didn't deorbit, what's the current state of the payload? Is it operational? Did anything actually go wrong? To this, we just might never know. And that's perfectly fine. After all, it's a classified payload with potentially sensitive and vital defense capabilities. If a bunch of YouTube armchair engineers could figure out what exactly it is, what it's doing, and all the other details of Zuma, that wouldn't bode very well for the United States' classified missions, would it? Sorry if that's not very exciting, but this was classified. It's classified for a reason and will remain that way until its mission is no longer critical or of any relevance. And although it's super fun to speculate, only a small handful of people actually have the answers here. And that's just the way it's meant to be. That being said, guess what? I still think it'd be fun to take a poll on what you think happened, so go ahead and fill that out and let's see who thinks what, because why not? Feel free to tell me what you think happened with the Zuma launch in the comments below, but please, let's not turn this into some kind of witch hunt. And although I won't be doing any future Zuma updates, most likely, I do have a lot of really cool videos coming out soon, and I can't wait for you to see them. I owe a huge thanks to my Patreon members for helping make this and other everyday astronaut content possible. I owe a special thanks to those patrons in our exclusive Discord channel for helping script and research. If you want to help contribute, please visit patreon.com/everydayastronaut. Thank you. Like always, all the music in my videos is original. Feel free to check it out and download it for free at soundcloud.com/everydayastronaut. Tell a friend. Thanks everybody, that does it for me. I'm Tim Dodd, the Everyday Astronaut, bringing space down to Earth for everyday people.